Welcome to the Goon Squad Sports Radio Show, First 40. I am Puma, along with Ice Water. We're going to be talking about a few subjects today. I'm going to throw in some subjects, Ice, on you. I know you've been watching it and hearing about it. But the first one is I had a talk with my dad earlier about Jared Cole, the 9-year contract. $324 million. And he is upset because he always says the Yankees try to buy a championship. And they just might have bought them one or keep Houston from getting the championship. What do you think about Cole's deal with the Yankees?
Well, it was the part, it was what the market allowed. I think your dad's absolutely right. The Yankees are always trying to buy a championship. And I've been trying to tell you about Jared Cole all last year, remember?
Yeah,
I tried to tell you. Now all of a sudden you're his biggest fan, aren't you?
Well, you love, I'm a big fan of the Yankees, so I can't use that against him. So
yeah, you love him now, don't you?
I'm in love with him now, man. Look at
that. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, okay.
That's what I'm saying. See what I'm talking about? I tried to tell you before. You didn't listen. Now all of a sudden he's sitting in your house and you're feeling real good. He's one of your cousins now. He can fight. He can throw them hands. But no, I think it's an amazing deal for the Yankees. That's what they do. They find ways, and Jared Cole is one of the best pitchers, along with some of the other staff that they have. And they really need somebody like this, particularly if he stays healthy. If the Yankees really want to win, they need somebody, because you lost C.C. Sabathia, a longtime soldier and veteran who just really tried, but he just simply ran out of physical tools. But, yeah, great day for the Yankees, but a lot of stuff happened in baseball, because now you have you look at the Dodgers trying to pick up Francisco Lindor from Indians.
Yeah.
And that'd be major. And then, of course, Philadelphia is like, don't sleep on us. We picked up. We just signed D.D. Gregorius. D.D. I like that. You know I like that. Look, gain one, lose one.
Yeah, that was a big loss for us. And Strasburg, man, getting re-signed with the Nationals, man, is real big. I thought that was a big-time contract until – the Cole contract last night. He's going to be playing up until what, about 38 years old, 39 years old?
And he won't make that far.
He won't make it that far, but they're giving him a boatload of money. Sure. And that's the Yankees. That's the Yankees way. You know, they're going to buy it. They got the money. Why not, you know, got it, flaunt it.
Have been that way since back in probably the 70s. You go back to the point when they signed Vida Blue from the Oakland A's. I know I'm getting old with y'all. Y'all understand this old man over here talking about that. But that significant for the point of major free agents. And they, with George Steinbrenner at the helm, and his offspring and others have continued to follow in his footsteps.
Well, the hot stove keeps burning in baseball, so we'll keep you up to date here on the Goon Squad. The other thing, before we talk about Le'Veon Bell, which I think was really kind of mind-blowing to me, but, you know, that's why Pittsburgh gave him up. We'll get to that a little bit later. New England Patriots get caught cheating again. And so it led me to think, man, that and I'm going to give you my views on it first, that you got to do something more drastic to the New England Patriots at this particular point. You can fine them. You can take their draft picks, but they're going to continue to cheat. They just can't help themselves. My thought was, and maybe you can give me some feedback on this. My thought is that maybe you should start putting asterisks every year that they've cheated on some asterisks on the side of their name when they won the Super Bowl or won a AFC North championship or gotten to the AFC. Start putting asterisks on their name and then given the reason why you put an asterisk on, to kind of taint them in history of why they keep doing this. And it seems like the punishments aren't enough. The $1 million punishments aren't enough. The draft pick, taking the draft picks aren't enough. They're going to continue to cheat, because if they weren't cheating, they would have let the NFL know that, hey, we're up in the press box and we're doing a documentary. We're not trying to cheat. They didn't say that. They got busted. And then there's like, oh, we're doing a documentary. My thing is, when you do a documentary in the NFL, you always let the NFL know that you're doing a documentary or what you're doing a documentary of. They just keep getting – are they just that stupid? Or they just keep thinking that, you know, they're like this the White House and the administration. They can do anything and get away with it. What's going on with this team, man?
Well, one, they're not stupid because they've been doing it for so long allegedly, and they've been getting away with it for so long allegedly, and they've been doing it with minimal punishment.
Yeah.
So with that being said, they're far from stupid. They know certain ways they can go, and they know the rules that they can bend. And until the NFL does something, as you mentioned, drastic, then they're going to keep doing what they're doing, or they might hide it for a minute or a little bit, and they'll pull it back out. But NFL's not going to do it. Come on, man. If Robert Kraft supposedly was caught dead to right in so many instances, allegedly, and what he had going on, and they just kind of brushed it over like,
we haven't heard about that story in a while.
No, he owned that mall. Well, they just happened to have a couple of girls down there massage, giving massages. I mean, what? So, I mean, it just shows you how they work, man. And then we only talk about the connection to 45 because I think that's different. But I'm just saying there's so many different things that come out and make you wonder why. So I'm not sure the NFL is going to do anything. When you first started talking, I initially thought you were talking about the Baseball Hall of Fame. Talking about asterisks, which is what they should do. Put P-Rolls in. Put a big old asterisk. Put a blot over his face so everybody know what the hell he did. But he's in. Yeah. That's what I think you should do with all the baseball terms. But, no, I mean – football is, the NFL has shown you who they are. And we humbly often wonder if it's going to improve or they're literally going to impose rulings that people think are fair and really clean things up. But I think, again, for the umpteenth time, they've shown you what type of organization that they are. They control the rules. They decide who gets punished, who doesn't get punished, who gets to walk away, and who they let play in their league. I think that's clear now. I think we as fans or people, if you don't like it, boycott, don't watch, I'm good with that. That's your choice. But know who they are. Know who they are. And if you think it's going to change overnight or expected to change, I don't see it. And simply because, last but not least, and no disrespect to the gentleman that's in charge of it now, is it Maurice, the Players Union right now?
Yeah.
But you need a person like Gene Upshaw that didn't take any BS.
Missed
and he got it done. Yeah, and he refused to take any stuff and whatever. But it's a new day. Game has changed. It's a lot cleaner, a lot easier, a lot faster, more points, a lot nicer. And again, the NFL still controls it the way they like to.
It's just sad that here we go again with the New England Patriots. And not to say that other teams don't do their kind of undercover cheating or espionage or whatever, but New England keeps getting caught. For some reason, they keep getting caught, and they keep getting tapped on the hand. And if you don't do a severe punishment, I just heard that they just met with Kraft an hour ago, and they were having a press conference. Okay, what are you going to talk to him about now? I mean, here we go again with the deflated footballs. Well, I mean, the list goes on and on and on. And so you have to really come down hard on this team to prove to me that, you know, you're kind of holding the shield up and the integrity of the shield, which to me doesn't have too much integrity anyway. But here you are presented with a case where the same team that you've been supposedly punishing and trying to create a deterrent for them to stop cheating, they're still cheating. They haven't stopped. So what do you do other than what you're doing now? Because what you're doing now is not hurt. It's like a parent. Like you're punishing a child and the punishment's not working. You got to take it to the next level. You got to take it to the next level.
Yeah. Well, their next level is probably going to be, well, I tell you what, we will take your first round draft pick from you the next 2 years. Patriots are going to win. they're like, I'm just saying that. They're going to be like number 25 anyway in the draft.
So yeah. It's like,
but that's what they'll do, and they will advocate for them to give money to another group, another nonprofit that needs some help and help certain individuals. But it's just, I'm telling you, one, Bob Kraft is too big and too important to the league. Okay, he really is. I said that over and over, and you're not going to restrict him too much because of his face, his value, and he's a leader in the league. And granted, you would think, no, you're not allowed to do that. But I've told you, I say it again, they make their own rules. Mm. You just got to get, it's not a regular business. Everybody wants to make it like it's your job. It's not your job. It's not your regular job. The job you go to every day, and they have rules, and they protect you, and you can go to, what is it? You can go to HR when you're feeling some kind of way, somebody treats you bad. Nah, bro. No. It's a different ball game. If you don't like it, you don't have to play. That's what they tell you. Yeah. If you don't like it, go to Canada.
Well, I'll leave it on this note. Happy endings for Kraft and the New England Patriots, and no happy endings for us as the fans watching this hypocrisy. Le'Veon Bell, man, this is why Pittsburgh Steelers got rid of Le'Veon Bell. And we said it maybe a couple of years ago when this was brewing, that Le'Veon Bell, and I said it on our podcast, that Le'Veon Bell is not going to be a Pittsburgh Steeler. Well, he got to the New York Jets and was declared he couldn't play because he had the flu. But yet, you know, the day before the game, he's out there bowling and bragging about it. Like, yeah, I was bowling out there and didn't play in week 14. The Pittsburgh Steelers did not want to pay this kid because, and I'm going to call him a kid because he acts like one, because he hadn't played a full season. He was getting in all types of trouble. And I always say bad optics. You know, if you're sick and you can't play, you shouldn't be out there in public bowling. And I blame his family, too, because he said he was out bowling with his family. And so they had to know that this didn't look really well in the public eye. When you're getting paid millions of dollars and you wanted to be that top back, you got the money, you said this is the team you wanted to play for. They declared that you couldn't play because you had the flu, and you said the doctors told you not to get on the field, stay away from the team, but you're able-bodied enough to go out there and bowl, and bragged about bowling his highest average of 250-something.
251, baby.
Yeah, 251. So this is why the Pittsburgh Steelers, all those folks is like, you know, Pittsburgh got rid of Antonio Brown, Le'Veon Bell. Big Ben has been quiet all of a sudden because their quarterback is balling, and they're making the playoffs without him. And those guys who were a distraction, Mike Tomlin has been coaching the best season I think he's coached since he's won the Super Bowl. And you get rid of these distractions. This is why, folks, that Le'Veon Bell did not get paid by the Pittsburgh Steelers. What are your thoughts about this, man?
I see it kind of twofold. I see exactly what you're saying. I think part of it with Le'Veon Bell is he has been pampered and spoiled like so many other athletes, which is why he decided he did not. He was going to sit out against for Pittsburgh during the season. And then they decided they didn't want to. But the flu situation is, I think it's just a total lack of respect for the ownership and particularly the coach. Because he said that if the doctors won't let me, I can't play, I might as well go bowl. They didn't say I couldn't bowl.
Yeah.
They didn't say I couldn't go to the bowling alley. They said I couldn't play. I was contagious. But my family, like, the hell with that. You want to go bowling? Oh, yeah, let me put my leather pants on. Let's go. But I'm just saying. I mean, it is it's really bad. If anybody's counseling him or directing him, it's really bad from that sense. But then again, he has his money, and that's the attitude. That's really attitude. I was thinking about that too. That do you realize that he has like only gained like only about 500 plus yards for the whole season? He's averaging 3 yards a carry, if that. But the team is not great. I'm telling you. When you look at how the team, Gase was coaching down in Miami, all the shenanigans that were happening down there, and now New York does this and bringing him in. I think the whole team has been full of shenanigans. I really do. And Le'Veon Bell is like, you know what? What? What you want? And then you know what they said about what Gay said? Well, we're going to talk to him about it, but we're not really going to find him or anything. We stuck with this dude for 4 or 3 more years. What are we going to do? We're going to trade him? I mean, we got too much money invested, so maybe we play nice. He'll play nice. Yo, man, you can't be doing that. Hey, buddy. Okay. I got you. All right, man. I won't do it anymore. I mean, that is too much investment. I agree with you about the Pittsburgh Steelers. The only thing I'm going to say about this is they had the best talent. All my thing I had is I had a problem with Tomlin not being able to coach the talent. Now, he is doing his best. Maybe this is what he needed to start all over. But I'm just saying, with the talent involved, and I say that as a Dallas Cowboy fan who was clearly aware of the White House and all of the shenanigans going on there, but they knew how to win.
Yeah.
They knew how to win. You, Pittsburgh, there's no reason why, and I'll say this real quick, there's no reason why I believe in the last so many years, Pittsburgh should not have won at least two championships.
Yeah, that's true.
Because I think they had the best offensive talent at one point, and the defense was coming on. So I don't know who you blame. Guys not acting right, but I just know, to me, it was a total waste of not – you should at least have two banners or two championships from the talent that they had on that roster a few years back.
And, folks, I'm not going to let Ice get that by you. He ain't talking about the White House in Washington, D.C. Look up the White House with the Dallas Cowboys and who ran the White House in the Dallas Cowboys organization or that team. Look it up. We ain't going to talk about it. Maybe we'll talk about it in overtime. But the infamous White House, Michael Irvin. Hi, shout out to Michael Irvin and them boys out down there.
Get a towel, Mike. Get a towel.
That's why Mike is always sweating on TV, because some of that White House story is going to come out one day. One day, one day.
Still my man, though. The playmaker. I love him.
Playmaker, yeah. NCAA football, man. We said that this was going to be a monster week, and it was, man. Georgia didn't make it. Oklahoma makes it over Baylor in overtime. And Ohio State almost got snuffed until the end there. Wisconsin was handling them. I want you to give some of your eye tests about this weekend. Clemson's holding in at number three, which we kind of knew that Clemson would hold in. But did you expect Wisconsin to come out so strong against Ohio State in that game?
Well, they played strong early in the first matchup. They did. And it took Ohio State a while to break loose. So I think I was surprised by the way that they came out. But two things happened for Ohio State. One, I think the inability for Justin Fields to be mobile. And I think he had a few nerves going on. I really do believe that. I think he had a few nerves. And I do not believe that the receivers were doing their darndest to get open. And the Wisconsin defense, particularly the defensive line, was coming at Fields all kind of ways. And he was down often. He actually sacked five times in that game. Sacked five times in the first game. So things were not happening, and the defense for Ohio State simply was not they were not on key, particularly when you have their running back, their quarterback, I'm sorry, run for two touchdowns early on. And all you had to do to see the difference in the changes that were made during the halftime tells you all you need to know. You look at how many yards they had, Wisconsin had in the first half, I think it was like 200-plus yards of offense, and I think they might have had less than 100 yards in the second half.
Yeah,
because Ohio State switched gears. They made adjustments and moved forward. So I think that hurt Ohio State by doing what they did, because people thought they would blow Wisconsin out. But Wisconsin's this is not a bad team. It's just, as I said before, I think styles make for the game. And I think eventually Ohio State was able to speed things up. Their defense got hot. They stopped Taylor. They closed up the middle, which would not allow the quarterback to run anymore. And then you start putting pressure on the quarterback, and you start throwing balls that start falling in the dirt.
Right.
And things just turn from that standpoint. So that means when your offense is off the field so quickly, then Ohio State's offense was able to move the ball and keep moving it, which put Wisconsin's defense on the field a lot longer. They get tired. Therefore, you kind of saw the eruption that happened. And Ohio State went on to win a game.
Moving on to these matchups, man. What do you like and what do you don't like about these matchups and the teams that might be at a disadvantage? Oklahoma, I know they outlasted Baylor, but in this Final Four, you're playing against some major, major defenses out there. I don't know if you can run the ball at these teams and kind of just do what you will on offense against these teams. And on the other side, these teams have some major league offenses that can put up a lot of points on the board. So does Oklahoma even have a chance?
Actually, out of the game, two games, I think Oklahoma has a big chance.
Okay.
I do, and I tell you why. I mean, no disrespect. I know it's a feel-good story. Joe Burrow came from the depths of Columbus, and they threw him away and went down to Baton Rouge and changed his name.
Baton Rouge.
And he's been fabulous. No disrespect. But on the other hand, too, look at Oklahoma.
Yeah.
The Baylor game, the first Baylor game, they were down. Jalen Hurts is a monster.
Yeah.
He can get it done. I don't know. if they can beat them, but I'm not going to just give it away. This is not, no disrespect, this is not Utah. This is not Washington, you know. CeeDee Lamb is a monster, man. I don't know if you watched him.
Yeah.
Oklahoma has an offense. They play hard. I think they have just as great a chance as anybody else. LSU is number one, and they proved, okay, you can give it to them. But they have to show now, this is the big boys. This is not Alabama without Tua, or Alabama would have hurt Tua, however you want to say. Alabama would have hurt Tua. But this is the real deal. Jalen Hurts, imagine that. He knows what it's like to play against LSU. He's defeated LSU.
Yeah.
I think you and then let's throw in Lincoln Riley, one of the greatest minds in college football right now, offensively. I think they have a shot. I'm telling you, I do. Maybe LSU's going to shut me up and score like they've been doing on everybody else. But watch Oklahoma. I think if it turns into a shootout and their defense is just as adequate as LSU's, I think they have a shot.
That's the big question. Can their defense step up? Oklahoma's defense step up, because that's been their Achilles heels for the last 3 years. The defense haven't been able to hold teams to under 35 or whatever points. And so if they get out in a shootout with any of these three teams, if they get a chance to play them, can the defense hold up? And that's been a big concern. So they'll have a few weeks to kind of figure that out. But that's going to be the big concern with me, especially with LSU. Ohio State can definitely roll up points. And then Clemson, they love to put up points with those great players, the receivers and running backs and that quarterback over there. So that's going to be the big test for Oklahoma. Can they really kind of hold teams down enough to score enough points to win with those other three? Guys, I think Clemson scored, what, 62 in their championship game? So that's nothing to sneeze at. So, but this is what I wanted to get to, bro. Uh-oh. DeVille.
Oh, wait a minute. I didn't get a chance to talk about more football real quick.
You want to talk about football? Go ahead. Get your football out. But we're going to talk about DeVille on campus.
Real quick. Go ahead. I know you antsy, but real quick. Ohio State, Clemson, okay? I think that game is going to be a phenomenal. Clemson has been waiting, chomping at the bit to show that they're worthy. Mm-hmm. After their near loss to North Carolina, they kind of been blowing opponents out or taking care of business. And I think this is a great matchup. Ohio State has a lot to play for. I think there's a lot to prove on both sides. And we'll see. I think part of it will come down to will. I really believe that. And I think that Ohio State, of course, has to get after their quarterback. He has to. Because if they don't, and they play the way that they did in that first half, they won't be able to come back against Clemson.
Not against Clemson.
Yeah, no. I mean, it was like when they tried to come back against Deshaun Watson. When you get down so much, there's nothing you're going to be able to do. But I think that they really understood it. They have 2 weeks to study. And this team is hungry. So I think it's going to be one hell of a matchup. And we'll see what happens. So I'm excited on both ends. I think the winner of that, telling you this right now, the winner of that Ohio State Clemson game wins the national championship. You heard that here first. I don't give a damn. I don't care if LSU wins. Yeah. I told you that. The winner wins the championship. Quote me on that. I know I'm going to be wrong. Y'all will come after me. I got big shoulders. I ain't handle it.
No, I tend to agree with you because they have a semifinal game in these playoffs where that's the championship game. Ohio State Clemson is the championship game. In my opinion, you know, no disrespect to LSU and Oklahoma and fans that they're watching out there, but these two teams, I mean, this is going to be a battle. And I hope that when these two teams play, they don't beat each other up enough that they just lay it on the platter for the next team that they play, because this is going to be defense against defense, offense against offense. They are, to me, evenly matched, and Clemson gets to defend their title.
Yeah. I'm with you, and I guess my thing there, though, is LSU, how big a stage has you been on? I need to see that.
Yeah.
It's one thing to play in the conference and play against Alabama, but this is for everything.
Yeah.
And the coach. Is the coach going to be able to handle it? Because, you know, he's been, at times, been a little shaky, a little nervous, start sweating like Michael Irvin. So we'll see what happens.
Oh, yeah. I thought you were talking about my man, the former LSU coach.
No.
If Black was on there, like, oh yeah, this, yeah. But
I'm talking about Ed O. Oh, ah.
Yeah, just the mumbles I call them. But yeah. Anyway, DeVille. Now you've been bragging on DeVille all week, and then
last year too.
Yeah, I was like, uh-oh. And so I want you to talk about DeVille, because nobody wants to be number one in college basketball. That's the spot that you don't want to be in. Kansas, you might be next on The Price is Right. So what happened in the DeVille game, man?
Well, they stopped going to the big fella inside, which they should have done. They should have gone to the big fella that they have inside. They didn't do that. And Texas Tech is very athletic.
Very good.
Even though they lost a couple guys from last year, they're very athletic and they came to play. They play hard defense. They almost, to a point, they match Louisville in what they like to do. Louisville likes to push it up and then they slow it down. They run that half court, kick it off, hit a couple of threes, drop it down to the big fella and move on. But last night, Texas Tech was ready. And like I said, that's not a slouch. And I'm not making any excuses. Louisville came worth their game. Texas Tech just outplayed them last night. But that does not mean that Louisville is still not top five, top 10 team. So that may not be number one. But ladies and gentlemen, when you mark your ballot and you get ready for March, I'm telling you this on December 11th, when you're ready to mark your ballot and looking for teams that might make moves, you might want to look at the Louisville Cardinals.
Got a pen out. The brother got his pen out.
I'm trying to tell you. I want you to get my point.
Listen, we do our picks on CBS every year. March Madness is like the best time of the year, College Bowl season and March Madness for us. And so we not only do the NFL picks that we're going to talk about in our 90-minute show after this in our podcast on Blog Talk, but we do our picks in the college basketball, which is fun. And it's going to be very, very challenging this year. Louisville's still number one. We got Kansas number two. They will not be number one after maybe this week when they put in the new rankings. You got Ohio State, who beat the stanky out of my North Carolina Tar Heels. Tar Heels have dropped down, I think, to number 17. They just don't have the offense. After Cole Anthony, they have nobody that can fill it up. And teams are recognizing that, and they're putting the clamps on Cole Anthony, the freshman. It's not fair, North Carolina. Get some offense. And if the running offense is not working, Coach Williams, change the system. I've been telling you that for years. You got Maryland, who I think was upset yesterday.
Penn State?
Yeah. Maryland, Michigan, still hanging in the top 10. They're at number 5, Gonzaga, Duke. You got Kentucky, Virginia, who had that number one spot. They're down. Oregon, Baylor, you have Auburn at number 12. They're moving up. Memphis, still hanging in there without their big guy Wiseman. So when he gets back after this 12-game suspension, I think they're going to move up the ranks. And I think he's still practicing with them. Followed by Dayton. Dayton is a strong team. We talked about that last week. Arizona, Michigan State. Michigan State and North Carolina, they were in the top 5. Now they're 16 and 17. That's how much parity you have in college basketball now. What are some of your eye tests and some of the teams and games that you were watching this week?
Yeah, the big fella I was talking about for Louisville is Enoch. He's a very talented player. Ohio State, North Carolina. Man. Mr. Holtzman, the coach is for Ohio State, is amazing. He has very talented veteran players who came back from last year. He has a group of freshmen and sophomores that are really playing real hard. The one thing I love about the Ohio State Buckeyes basketball team is they play defense.
Yeah.
They play hard defense, and then they use offense as kind of their reward. Reminds me of I'm not going to say they're the same team, but the same attitude. A lot of people don't want to give him credit for that. A lot of the talent reminds me of the old UNLV running Rebs.
You know what? I was thinking about that when I was watching the game.
They play hard defense and they get excited about playing offense.
Yeah.
I mean, I just only thing I wish Coach Holtzman would throw in would be that thing they used to call the amoeba defense, kind of matching zone defense. I love that. That's how you play basketball. But yeah, they're really good. We talked about that before. Up and down, Auburn, up and down. I think it was Virginia that came back and they were able to beat Auburn. So Virginia kind of rallied, got off the mat after getting blown out and rallied to beat some other different teams. So a lot of good teams in there overall. Big Ten is full of talent. Like you said, Penn State gets blown out by Ohio State, comes back around, tops Maryland. topsy turvy. I know you want Kansas to drop. You want to get off my man Azubuki.
I'm not gonna hate on Kansas no more, man. I'm just gonna back and watch. I'm not gonna think negative about them anymore.
But I think it's showing you though that you have a lot of teams that have come up now, and you're gonna be surprised. You're gonna be some losses, okay? Nobody's gonna run the table. You're not gonna probably see the dominant teams that we saw like in Duke.
Right.
Before you had all of this talent, all this freshmen, and you didn't think they would ever lose. I think it's gonna be more team oriented, which makes for better basketball, because that means you're gonna have your whole game, your whole team ready. And you can't take anybody for granted, because if you thought the tournament was good this year, wait till 2020. It's going to be exciting. I'm looking forward to a lot of basketball. And you got teams like Illinois. You mentioned DePaul. Illinois is playing decent. DePaul. Georgetown lost a lot of their players, but they're still finding ways with a Mac McClung. You get it done. Eminem is getting it done. So
it's sensational.
And one last team I'll say very quickly, because I know we're getting ready to go. But watch out for St. John's, man.
Yeah.
Mike Anderson, yeah. Mike Anderson has some guys buying in. They may not win it all, but they're playing hard. Playing real hard for him.
Yeah. I got a feeling that a team that's going to have a lot of juniors and seniors and some experience may pull off a championship this year. That maybe from a mid-major, maybe from a team we're not expecting that has that kind of senior leadership, that because we got a lot of young teams that are popping up number one or popping up in the top five, and then they get popped and then they're down. But, you know, forget about these one and dones. Look at the guys who put the work in and have some experience, and they're coming out and they're playing, and this is their last shot. It may be a team with some senior leadership, that guard play that we talk about, the senior guard play that may come through the tournament and really kind of just go on a 6-game winning streak to the championship. But speaking on that, let's go to not quite there yet, but the NBA, a big game tonight with Toronto and the Clippers. Kawhi going back to Toronto to pick up his ring that he well-deserved last year. Got Milwaukee 16-0. In the last 16 games, they're coming on. They're a scary team to me, because last year when I saw them play, they were just beating the brakes off anybody in the West. And they are looking at that. To me, I thought that loss that they have, you never want to say a loss was a good thing for a team, but Milwaukee was like more of a growing pain. And the Greek Freak needed that to kind of get him more hungry, because he won the MVP, but he's like, that's not enough. That's you know, small things. I want the championship. You got Milwaukee, Boston, and Miami. Jimmy Butler, I'm going to give him his credit. He's playing well in Miami. We'll see how long that lasts. He had three triple doubles in the last few weeks. You got Philly, who was really disappointing to me. Toronto, they lost Kawhi Leonard. So, you know, whatever they can do this year to get to the playoffs, they've earned their right. Your boy is not back with Indiana yet, but that's all I want to talk about in the East. But you got the Lakers, the Clippers, Dallas number three in the conference. Houston is number four. That has to be a disappointment. That has to be a disappointment. All about Denver, Utah, OKC. CP3 is really taking that leadership role to heart in OKC. And you know what? They're playing some ball over there. 6-4 in their last 10. I thought Phoenix was going to be the hot team. They're tied at 11-12 with OKC, but we'll see what they do. They're 4-6 in their last 10. See if they can get back on a roll. But give me your eye test, man, of the NBA real quick.
Yeah, you mentioned about Phoenix. I mean, nothing's going to really turn around until Ayton returns. We know that.
Right.
I think this really has a lot to do with that. I'm puzzled by San Antonio. I would expect them to try to make some moves, and they're not going to do anything. This might be Pop's last year. 9-14 right now.
Yeah.
It does not look good at all. As you mentioned, Denver's falling off a little bit. Houston is surprising, because people want to throw dirt on them. I told you, wait until it's time. And again, the teams that they've been losing to have been the teams that primarily been the champions. When you also look at Miami, Jimmy Butler getting things done. Also, I'm going to throw one other thing. I've been saying this guy's name, and granted, when you turn, look at the standings, you're not going to say anything. You're not even going to recognize his team. But the Charlotte Hornets and Devontae Graham, bro.
Yeah.
He is playing some ball. I'm so happy for him, because people don't understand, when you play professional sports, sometimes you have to be in the right place with the right team.
Right.
Granted, it's a rebuilding project down there, but this young man is stepping his game up and showing you that he's worthy of being maybe not the franchise or the marquee player on the team, but he's definitely worth a look and worthy of being in the NBA. I love this because he's young, and they have a few other young players down there too, just trying to build for the future. And if Michael Jordan really wants to do things right, he'd follow up by just increasing to get better players and letting these young guys play and turn into something for them down the line.
Yeah, Devontae Graham from the University of Kansas, one of them tough guys from the University of Kansas. All right, man, we have our picks coming up in the next 90 minutes on our overtime show on Blog Talk Radio. We all did really well last week. We all got there different ways, but we all got a 12-4 record. I don't know how that happened. I had to double check and triple check. Did we all get 12-4? But we did in different ways because we made a little bit different picks.
I got one thing to say.
Go ahead.
That Tampa Bay game was bullshit. They should have lost. Famous James, mother sucker. Damn.
I thought the Giants had Philly last night, man, or Monday night, man, and man, they just let me down again. Every chance they get, they let me down. But that Dallas, my pop called me twice this week. He rarely calls me during a Dallas Cowboy game. He was so mad at that Cowboy game. He was like, they're trying to get the coach fired tonight. This is how they're playing. I could not believe that they lost against the Bears like that. But we're going to talk about that a little bit more in the next hour because the Bears aren't that good. Now you got Hale Trubisky here in Chicago for the last week and a half.
I told you, when you texted me, I did not watch 1 minute of that damn game. Wow. I saw the score and I was like, I'm good. I can't do it.
Wow. But I'm still in the lead, followed by Pop. I think I'm 8 games in front of him. Ice is in third. Black is in fourth place. I know he just texted me if he could hear the beep. He's probably sending in his picks right now. But, man, it's been one weird year where you think that what you think is going to happen, not going to happen.
And, but it's your year, and I'm happy for you. It's your year.
Yeah.
Finally, it's your year. But you know what? Basketball coming up. So don't you better hold on to your trophy. You better take your year run like they do in boxing, because March is coming, baby. Yeah, like Black Thor is coming, March is on its way.
I need to get my Streets and Smith magazine for college basketball and do some more studying, because this is really watching these games, I'm pulling my hair out. But we're going to end this portion of the first 40 here on YouTube. And we're going to go into our overtime show on Blog Talk Radio. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Also, come and hang out with us and listen to our podcast on Blog Talk Radio 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, the Goon Squad Sports Radio Podcast. We will see you in the few. Take care.